out of respect for you all, I'm going to start the evening's proceedings. I'm Josh Ginsburg. I'm the president of the Cary Institute, and I'm on a very winter day. Thank you all for coming out. Of course, I'll, you know, I'll talk a little bit about why it's so appropriate. But I wanted to mention first, something happened this week that was unusual and worth noting. Our scientists are distinguished and authoritative, each one of them. It doesn't really matter whether you just got here and you're relatively speaking young, early in your career, or you've been here for your entire career. Each of them is authoritative in their own remarkable way. Our founder, Gene Likens, whom some of you may have heard talk last June in the NNAMES lecture, is particularly distinguished among our peers. And Gene this week won something called the BBVA, or if you're Spanish, the BBVA, Frontiers of Knowledge Award in Ecology and Conservation Biology. This is a big deal, right? It's not just some award. It has a very large cash award with it. But the people who have won this, it's only been given 9 times, include Cary Institute trustee Tom Lovejoy, a Nobel School graduate, but also people like E.O. Wilson at Harvard and Paul Ehrlich at Stanford. They're household names in ecology, and there aren't many household names in ecology. And so it is a tremendous honor. And in part, what Gene won it for was, along with Martin Schaefer, it was great to give it to Martin Schaefer, who is a Dutch biologist whose work on tipping points. In other words, you get to some place and then it switches. And Malcolm Gladwell made that popular in a broader sense, but what they won the award for was their remarkable contribution, and I'm going to quote it here, to understanding where possible and anticipating ecosystem responses to human-induced alterations of the natural environment. So, Gene, a guy named Kurt Borgman at Yale started at a place called Hubbard Brook, and I'll get to why that's important, about 50 years ago. Gene just published a book with Richard Holmes called Hubbard Brook, The Story of a Forest Ecosystem, about which he spoke in June. This award-winning book has talked about 50 years of research at the USDA Forest Service experimental forest at Hubbard Brook. And it is the reference site for temperate forest and ecosystem science. They've done all sorts of crazy things, some of which Lindsey will talk about today. And science really is the quintessential public-private partnership. Right? We talk about public, and we like to sort of own it a little. But then the USDA and you guys as taxpayers really own it. And then there's Cornell and Dartmouth and New Hampshire and Yale, and it just keeps going. It's a partnership that goes across public and private sectors. And it is quintessential and important to the way science works in our society. So it is a privilege to have been engaged with it. We now run, Aaron Lovett, who's here tonight, is head of the LTER, which stands for the Long-Term Ecological Research Program at Hubbard Brook, which recently came to Cary Institute from Cornell. And we are proud of this partnership. And so the award to Gene for his work on acid rain at Hubbard Brook and on ecosystem science more generally. Couldn't come on a better week because it's my pleasure to talk about Dr. Lindsey Rustad. So Lindsey graduated from Cornell and Yale, the University of Maine, and various other places. She's a distinguished scientist, but her job is as a sort of a Forest Service head of Hubbard Brook. Right, so her title is the team leader for the Forest Service Hubbard Brook Experimental Research Forest of the USDA, which is part of the Northern Research Station Center for Research on Ecosystem Change. And I wrote that a lot. But for 20 years, Lindsey has been doing research with a multidisciplinary team looking at human impacts on forests and how these disturbances affect forests at different scales. She has a passion for communication, but particularly communication between and synthesis between ecosystem, regional, and global change scientists, which is a way of saying different scales. Scientists tend to look at things in their own little box. And what Lindsey does, and I hope she'll do for us tonight, is cut across those boxes. And she'll do that by talking about ice storms. And ice storms, of course, is something that many of us know, and I won't say love, but experience regularly. And so it's going to be a wonderful lecture. And before Lindsey gets up, I just noticed I have three things in my hand to mention. So next month, on March 10th, Dave Strayer, Emeritus Ecosystem Scientist at the County Institute, will be talking about the other blue kind. We talk a lot about marine, but there's a whole other blue, and that's the fresh water. He's going to talk about the diversity of the world's fresh waters. Okay, it's an engaging lecture. I hope you can make that. And then we are going to have a lecture by Terry Tempest Williams on Earth Day. It's a Saturday. Did I say it's a Saturday? So we're breaking out of the Friday night of Terry on April 22nd, which I say is Earth Day. Finally, there is a walk. I'm going to find it. Winter Forest. Tree identification Sunday, February 18th. Please note, it is already full, but there is always a waiting list, so if you're interested, go on the waiting list. We often clear off the waiting list. Anyway, I've done my job. So, Lindsey, it is a pleasure to have you at the Carey Institute. You did a really good job. We didn't have ice, we had snow, and we had ice.
Various colleagues, some of whom are in the audience, so it's always great to be here. And I think it was kind of fortuitous that we had the big snowstorm yesterday, because that was kind of a prelude to what we're going to be talking about today. So that was a large storm, and I know I'm from Bay. I was in New Hampshire, actually, at Hummerbrook last night, and it closed down schools and businesses and roads, and it was really quite a big deal. In fact, this morning, Boston schools and Maine schools were still closed from this big storm, and part of the storm was a big iceberg. So I thought that was kind of the prelude to my talk, and I'm sure that's why you all came out. You had a big storm, and you get no more down storms. So I'm not going to talk about snow. I'm going to talk about ice storms, and I'm going to share with you some research that we've been doing at the Hunter Group of Experimental Boards that we just heard about up in New Hampshire. And I'm going to start by asking the audience three questions. I'm going to ask you questions before you ask me questions. So I'm just curious, you can raise your hand, how many people in here have actually been in an ice storm? Wow, okay, here you go. How many people have missed work or school because of an ice storm? Okay. How many people have been out of power because of an ice storm? Okay, well, my first question that I'm not going to ask is how many people know someone who's been out in an ice storm, and that's too sad to ask, but we know that happens as well. So I live, again, in Maine. We have ice storms fairly regularly, and my first experience with an ice storm was the ice storm of 1998. And living in Maine, we were actually without power for 2 weeks. I had three children under the age of six, and it was one of the longest 2 weeks of my life, I have to tell you. And it was not just the inconvenience of power and water and food and all that, but it was really looking out my back door at the destruction and the loss of trees and branches. It was just kind of one of those life-changing events, and so I've been fascinated by ice storms ever since. So this is one of my favorite images of my 30 years of research. This is my graduate student, Wendy Lewenberger, and she's taking some notes after one of our icing treatments last year at the Hunter Brook, and it brings to mind three different things for me. One, if you've been in an ice storm, particularly the beginning of an ice storm or light icing, they're incredibly beautiful events, right? They're striking, and particularly the sun comes out, right after it's been ice, it's just magical. And I'm sure that Disney modeled Frozen after a snowstorm, but an ice storm. So this is just a beautiful, beautiful image. But we also know that in an ice storm, as that ice accumulates, right, there's almost a tipping point even before the branches begin to break, that it goes from the sublime and the beautiful to the really terrifying and frightening. And so for me, this image kind of mother in me that says, Wendy, get out of there, right? You gotta flee. And then the third thing, it's science, right? You know, it's a perseverance of researchers, science, you know, being out in the middle of things, you know, recording what's going on and trying to understand cause and effect between these natural disturbances and what happens short-term, long-term. So Maria's one of my favorite images, and I do have to tell you a secret. She was not in the middle of the iceberg. We had a professional photographer that we had the privilege of coming out when we were doing the icing, and he kind of created this illusion of her standing in the middle of the iceberg. So I would probably be fired from my job at the Forest Service if I sent a graduate student out in the middle of the iceberg. But anyway, there's kind of a start. So what I want to do today is talk about four different things. I'm going to start with why we care. And clearly a lot of you care because you're here and you've been in Uncertainties. But generally, why do we care about these events? Then I want to talk about what do we know, which is some, but not all that much. What do we need to know? And then I'm going to spend most of the time talking about our ICE experiment. So, why do we care? And I want to step back for a minute and talk about this under the umbrella of climate change. And I know this is kind of an incendiary picture, but it's kind of incendiary times, so not maybe it was appropriate. But if you're like me, I've actually been studying on climate change and its impacts on forested ecosystems for going on 3 decades now. And we know unequivocally, right, that atmospheric CO2 has been going up over the last 100 years. We know unequivocally that as CO2 and methane and nitrous oxide go up, temperature goes up and has gone up by about 1 degree C over the last 100 years. And we know that as you put more energy into the atmosphere, you intensify the hydrologic cycle, and we know we're seeing a redistribution of precipitation around the globe. If you follow the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change reports, they first came out in 1990. They've been coming out at about 5-year intervals. And this is a body of scientists representing thousands of scientists that regularly synthesize the accumulated information on climate change. And if you're kind of geeky like me and kind of always read these whenever they come out, I will remember when they first came out and all of them kind of hidden between them. They always have this term said, well, we think there's going to be an increase in the frequency and severity of extreme weather events every time they come out. Well, the last one that came out in 2013-2014 was much more forthright about extreme events, a lot more language about increasing the frequency and severity of extreme events. And this is just an example of a figure from that report where we begin to see that, wow, we have about a 1 degree C increase in temperature, we're going to have moderate to high risk from extreme weather events. So the language has gotten much stronger. Also have figures like this that talk about the different kinds of extreme events. And I think we can understand that precipitation, heat wave, cold wave, we know a fair amount about them. This is knowledge and our ability to detect extreme events on the x-axis, understanding the causes on the y. So we know a fair amount about some types of extreme events and the causation and the linkage with climate change. This is just an example of a National Academy of Sciences report about the attribution of some of these types of extreme events to climate change. Well, way down here is ice. Okay, we don't know much about them. It's hard to detect them. We don't really understand the causes. And as you guys all know, when you have an ice storm, you're not out studying ice storms, right? You're home, protecting hearth and home and trying to be safe and then digging out afterwards. So we don't know much about these. So why do we care? Even though we don't know much about them, we do know that they're common causes of disturbance in north temperate arboreal forest ecosystems worldwide. This is a photo from New Hampshire of the 1998 ice storm not far from Hunter Brook. Here is a photo from the Great Ice Storm of 2008 in China. And then there is another humongous ice storm in Slovenia in 2014. Just to illustrate that these large ice storms do occur worldwide. again, if you're like me, and you have a Google alert on your iPhone to look at ice storms every day, we have had a lot of ice storms in the U.S. And in southern Canada. There we had a huge one in Maine in December. We had them in the Midwest, Oklahoma, Missouri, freak ice storm in Colorado, Oregon, Washington, and a huge ice storm in New Brunswick. So a lot of ice storms, they occur more frequently than actually I would even have thought when I first started on studying these. So why do we care? In the United States, they account for roughly 60% of winter storm losses. They have caused more than $16 billion in insured losses between 1950 and 2000. A lot more since then, and a lot of uninsured losses, and I know mine going to that category of uninsured losses. They're a major cause for infrastructure disruption. We get even a couple tenths, even one-tenth an inch of ice, and roads closed, schools closed, businesses closed. A lot of disruption, and of course, loss of life. I mean, even this year, I haven't added it up, but in all those ice storms I mentioned, there were traffic accidents, and people were dying, and up in New Brunswick, there were also several deaths due to carbon monoxide that people were trying to heat their homes from the power went out for 4 or 5 days. So, a lot of reasons that we need to know more about ice storms. So, my next area is, well, what do we know? And so, looking a little bit more closely at that, there's some things that we do know. We have some idea where ice storms occur, and there's a broad ice storm belt that extends from northeast Texas up through just about here, maybe up through the Berkshires. We know the return intervals of ice storms. Return interval for the large ice storms, like the 1998 storm, are 35 to 85 years. Moderate ice storms, maybe a quarter inch radial ice accretion, 5 to 10 years. And we all know that we're seeing light icing, basically, on an annual basis. We do know the conditions, the unique conditions under which ice storms form. And this is just height above ground over here, and this is temperature. And of course, high up in the atmosphere, precipitation is frozen. And when we have a warm air layer over a very cold air layer, the frozen rain, the frozen precipitation melts in the warm air, falls through the cold air, and under those conditions where it super cools, doesn't turn back to ice, but it super cools, hits frozen surfaces, and it basically freezes on contact. So we know what those conditions look like. We also know some of the broader synoptic weather conditions under which ice storms form. One is called the cold air override, and I think it should be the warm air override because it's warm air overriding cold. And I excuse the poor quality of the slide, but I think you can see it's this collision, cold fronts, some of these Arctic cold fronts with these warm air masses coming up from the Gulf or coming up the Atlantic Ocean. So these are the conditions where we can be looking for them. And also cold air damming. So in mountainous terrain, you can have cold air that's trapped by the topography, and if you have warm air coming in on the other side, it's going to override that cold air in great conditions suitable for ice storms. And so that's why we have more ice storms in mountainous terrain. So we have some idea of locally how they form and more broad conditions of how they form. So the million-dollar question, of course, is what's it going to look like in the future? And I don't have a crystal ball, but there are a group up in southern Ontario, Cheng, and his colleagues who reported out in 2007 and again in 2011. They used statistical downscaling techniques for 15 sites in southern Ontario to try and predict what future freezing rain events would look like. So they created all these different graphs for the sites, and their results suggest a 40 to 85% increase in freezing rain events by 2050. Here's a trend, just to zoom in on one of these. This is the observed number of freezing rain events in an average winter, so it might be 5 days that they would get freezing rain event. right now, and these are the model reconstructions. So this is the historic reconstruction, underestimates it maybe a little bit, but you can see the expected increase over time. If we have an increase in ice storms, that is a big deal. We need to know that. We need to be prepared for that. So this is our first hint of connecting what we know about past climate to what we're learning about future climate. So what do we know about forest susceptibility to ice storms? Well, we know some things. We know certain tree characteristics make certain tree types, tree species, more resilient to icing. We know a lot about wood properties, the tensile strength of wood, how it bends. The wood products industry has a lot of information about that, so we can predict whether a tree is more likely to bend, right, like a white birch, or snap, more like a beech or maple. Canopy architecture is a big deal. If your tree, right, your branches up, yeah, or down, you're going to be more likely to shed ice than if you have branches that are horizontal. If you're a softwood like a spruce, a fir, or a hemlock, honestly, you watch them, they just shed the ice. They just kind of collapse like an umbrella, and then they come right back up. Rooting depth, if you have deep roots, trees are more likely not to topple over, makes sense, than shallow-rooted trees. And regeneration, after an ice storm, you can regenerate quickly, like beech, right, from beech roots. You're more likely to have a competitive advantage. And those of us who work at places like Hovergrove or Maine, Bear Grove, or maybe the Catskills, after the ice storm, we know that beech came back with a vengeance. We actually call it beech hell. You know, you're trying to get through this. It's impossible to get through this. And that's all the beech coming back after the ice storm. We also know that weather variables can intensify in ice storms. So the temperature during an ice storm, during an ice storm when that lower cool air layer is 29, 30, there's a lot of dripping going on. If that cool layer is more like 22 or 25, that is just going to be pretty solid, and that ice is going to build up a lot more quickly. Temperature after the storm, you'll have an ice storm, and it comes out bright and sunny and warm the next day, the ice melts right off. Right, those trees act like huge solar collectors. It melts off very quickly. It'd be very cold temperatures, that ice is going to hang around. The longer it hangs around, the longer the more options or more opportunities for those branches to break. So all moisture, saturation prior to the storm. If you had kind of a wet, warm period, and in an ice storm, you have all that weight in the trees, and you just watch those trees just topple right over. So the water saturation, soil saturation beforehand. And then wind speed. Right? That's kind of intuitive. If you have higher wind speeds, you're going to have more abrasion of the canopy, a lot more breakage. In the 1998 ice storm where I was in Maine, we had fairly high winds. And it was quite friendly as you would just kind of hear these branches breaking. So wind is a big thing. And those are things that we can understand and forecast. Well, what about biology? What do we know about how ecosystems respond to ice storms? And here's where we get on kind of thin ice, if you will. We don't really know that much. We do know something from the 1998 ice storm, really at Howard Brook. So the 1998 ice storm occurred between January 4th and 10th, 1998. It covered over 40,000 square miles across New England and up into Canada. We saw up to 5 inches of radial ice accretion. I mean, that's insane. That's a tremendous amount of ice. Costs over $2 billion in damage, and there were over 44 reported fatalities. So at Howard Brook, of course, you've heard we've been doing long-term studies, actually for 60 years. And we had a lot of studies in place. We were able to get some quick funding from the National Science Foundation and also from the Forest Service to quickly look at this study. And so there's a bunch of papers that have come out, and just to give you a flavor of it, we do know that we lost about a third of the leaf canopy, opening up big gaps, and it took up to 3 years for that canopy to fill back in. We know that it changed the canopy structure, regeneration, species composition, and we know that was still altered 8 years after the ice storm, and we know we can still see the signature of the ice storm now up in those watersheds. We know that the storm damaged trees' fine roots. We know that that soil temperatures went up. This is some of Jane Lincoln's work out at Harvard Brook. And curiously, we didn't see a change in soil moisture or microbial nitrogen dynamics. And even though we didn't see that change, we did see a big pulse of nitrogen coming out of those watersheds in soil solutions and in streams. And so that led us to the conclusion that the ice storms damaged the canopy, damaged the roots of those plants, those trees were not taking up nitrogen, and that nitrogen instead was going out the system in surface water and, of course, contributing to downstream water quality issues. So real signature at Hubbard Brook, big pulse of nitrogen after the ice storm. Remember that point, and I'm going to come back to it. So this is probably the most intensely studied ice storm anywhere in the world. We also know Wallace Chernow and Kevin Smith went back to Plotsnot at Hubbard Brook and across the Northeast to look at, well, how did these trees, these forest stands respond over time? So 15 years later, they revisited plots and they found that 90 to 100% of the least damaged maple and ash survived, right? They did okay. Trees that lost less than half their crown, they survived. They did okay. Trees that were healthier to start with, they survived. Those that were already stressed, already had pest pathogens, they are the ones that did not survive. Trees with deep, healthy root systems, they survived. And in general, they found that conifers were more resilient than ash, than maple equals beech, than birch. And we all, I think, are familiar with the birch, the white birch that bend over and don't do. So again, fair amount of work, more than anywhere else in the world that we've been able to find. A little bit of work after the Chinese ice storm, just telling you a little bit about that. That occurred January 10th to February 6th in 2008, almost 3 weeks of freezing rain. Covered over, 80,000 square miles, 19 provinces in China. They claimed up to 3 to 6 inches of radioactive accretion. Again, just a tremendous amount of ice. They reported 130 fatalities, 1.7 million people displaced, and huge damage to forest and crops. There is some results or some research from this study. Most of it is socioeconomic. Most of it is about crop damage. So there wasn't really the opportunities we had at Hunter Brook to study the response of the forest. There are a few papers that you can dig up that look at, you know, the relationship between the size of the canopy gap and then certain, you know, forest soil properties, but it's really hard to find it. And most of what was written is published in the Chinese literature, and it's really hard for us to get a hold of that. So some papers, but not that much. So in sum, what do we know? We know that ice storms are a major cause of disturbance. We know that they occur worldwide. We understand the local meteorological conditions under which they occur. We're beginning to understand the larger scale kind of synoptic conditions under which they occur. We know something about the impacts on forests. We have some understanding of how forests recover from these events. And we have some indication from our Canadian colleagues that these storms may become more frequent over the coming decades. So, we know some things, not all that much, but we have a lot of question marks. So very briefly, with our research colleagues, the three questions that we wanted to ask was, first and foremost, back to this question is, what will be the future frequency and severity of ice storms? Right? If we can answer that question, we can be more prepared. You know, will they be the same? Will they be less? Will there be more of them? Can we use some of the techniques that Chang et al. Have used to appear into our own crystal ball here in the Northeast. With that, what are the short-term kind of direct and indirect effects of ice storms on forests, and then what are the longer-term, the legacy effects of ice storms? So these are some of the big questions that we wanted to know more about. And these are what God is thinking about during this large ice storm experiment. And I have to tell you a story. I actually started thinking about doing this when I was on a highway up in Berkshires, and I was actually coming from the Cary, and I was going back up to Maine, which is where I live, and I'm going through the Berkshires, and the road looked like this, and there were cars off the road every which way, and the forest looked like this, and it was white knuckling it the whole way, and it was an absolutely terrifying experience. And I got back up to my office in Durham, New Hampshire, and I went to my colleague and my buddy, John Campbell, and I said, John, this is just an incredible, you know, storm that we have. What do we know about ice storms? You know, this must have just wreaked havoc, you know, on our forests. And so we kind of did some investigative work in the literature, and kind of found that we didn't really know that much about it, really knew pretty much what I just presented to you. And so John and I started scratching our heads and saying, well, gee, you know, how can we study these events? And so we looked at this map, which again shows kind of where these storms occur, and we said, yes, we can be storm chasers. Right? We'll put together, you know, a rapid assessment team, and ice storm will come, and we'll go out, and we'll study it. Well, we spent a couple months watching the weather, just to see what it looked like, and as you can imagine, these storms are very sporadic, they're very unpredictable, and being an ice storm chaser was a terrible idea. So we scratched that idea, and we said, well, we both work at Howard Brook. Right, and Howard Brook, you know, is our outdoor laboratory. So instead of going to the ice storms, maybe we can bring the ice storms to Howard Brook. If you haven't been to Howard Brook, Howard Brook is in central New Hampshire. It's in the White Mountains. It's approximately an 8,000-acre bowl-shaped valley. And it was established actually in 1955 by the U.S. Forest Service as a center for hydrologic research for the region. We've been studying the hydrology, the meteorology, the vegetation, the chemistry, just about everything biogeochemically that you can think of since the early 1960s. So we had a wealth of information. We had the most intensely studied ice storm was there. So it was really not just the fact that we worked there, but it was really one of the most perfect places to study ice storms. We have something else going for us at Charter Brook. We have the greatest team, a greatest staff, I think, of anywhere in the world. And leading this is Ian Palm. He is our site manager, and he's one of those go-to people, and he can kind of do anything. So John and I went to Ian a little sheepish, and we said, well, Ian, we have this really crazy idea. We really want to make ice storms. Can you make ice storms? And Ian, who's a firefighter for the Forest Service and is chief of the fire department in our local fire department, said, sure, we can do that. We're going to do it up there. And so in 2009, 2010, we started playing around, right, with fire hoses and pumps and spraying water up in the air with different nozzles. And lo and behold, it's not rocket science that you put water up in the air and it comes down on the canopy supplying mist, and when it's really cold, gee, it freezes. But what we realized is we could kind of control the amount of ice that we were putting on this forest, and that was the key. Not just putting ice there, but we could create a suite of different controlled ice storms. And so we took this and we went to the Northern States Research Collaborative, and we got money to do a pilot ice storm study that we did in 2011. We did this on a small 15 by 15 meter replicated plots. We did this with fire hoses. Again, I'm not sure OSHA would like this. We held up fire hoses and we sprayed the trees, but it did work. And we did create an ice storm that basically simulated the 1998 ice storm. This blue line, and I kind of go back and forth between metric and English, I apologize, but the blue line was radial ice accretion for the 1998 ice storm in Hampshire, and these bars are the main radial ice accretion that we achieved in our icing experiment. So not exactly on top of the line, but pretty close, and it looked a lot like what we had photographs for from the 1998. We also devised these really funky, we call them ordinates, you know, how to measure ice, right? You know, even the Weather Service doesn't know how to measure ice. Often they do that on a thin, let's see if I have it, on a thin wire, and ice is measured as radial ice accretion. So if you hear about a half inch radial ice accretion, it's really an inch of ice. They're a little deceptive. So you measure it that way, but we didn't want to measure it on something that didn't look like a tree, so we created these wooden ornaments, and we measured ice accretion on this, and this has worked pretty slick. So this is just a little bit of data. We created these gaps in the canopy. This shows that canopy openness, no difference pre and post in our control plots, and we saw a significant increase in canopy openness in our treatment plots. Kind of boring graph, but just to point out, this is fine litter. That's little stuff, less than about an inch. It's a twigs, it's a buds. We got about 142 kilograms carbon per hectare, but the noteworthy point is that's roughly similar to what this site gets in a single year. So we got down in one storm what the system usually gets in a whole year, including the that was actually kind of a big deal. And then this is coarse litter, so this is the bigger branches, anything bigger than about an inch. And we got 217 kilos carbon per hectare per year, and the point being that's an order of magnitude more than we would typically get. So this is some of the first data that we have beginning to quantify, you know, the relationship between a certain level of icing and the amount of coarse and fine weight free that came down. Now, my husband kind of makes fun of me when I do these things. He's like, well, Lindsey, you know, you ice things, you know, of course you're going to get coarse and fine weight debris down. I said, yes, but you know how much? You know, and that's, you know, what we're beginning to get. And then what happens to it, right? Are those nutrients recycled by the trees, or are they decomposed and lost out the bottom? Not just how much twigs in it and bark and limbs we get down, but it's what happens to it. So we took that information, this is kind of how science is done, and we went to a bunch of our best friends and colleagues, Peter Grothman, you know, a couple folks from here at the Cary, and we proposed that we do this in a bigger way, much more comprehensive. And we wrote a proposal to the National Science Foundation, which was funded on understanding the impacts of ice storms on forest ecosystems in the northeastern United States. And these are all senior folks that have worked, but really one of the honor and privilege of doing this kind of work is really all the students and the staff that work on this in the summer, year-round, the folks that come up to do the icing. We have just dozens of people who have been inspired by this experiment. So that's really been one of the highlights for me about working on this experiment. So we call it the full ice, and in our proposal we combine theory of how what we think is going to happen with long-term monitoring, what happens to the forest over decades, with big biogeochemical and climate models, and experiments, and then try to bring it all together. So theory, we have all these funny squiggly spaghetti lines of what we think is going to happen. We've done the icing, now we can follow to see if we're right or wrong. We actually have plots that were set up by the Forest Service in 1998 across New Hampshire and Vermont. We sent a crew out to them to resample them, similar to what Molly and Kevin did, so we can look at the response and recovery of the forest 18 years later. Charlie Driscoll is refining the peanut biogeochemical modeler. Catherine Cahoe, if you're familiar with her name, is doing climate models, modeling similar to what Dr. Chang and his colleagues were doing. And then, of course, we're doing the ice experiment. So I go through all of this just to say there's am going to focus on the experiment for the remainder of our time. So just as the setup, so I just like to know what's the approach. So we had 10 20 by 30 meter plots in the Hutterbrook Valley, and each one of those, if you can imagine the size of a basketball court, or roughly the size of this room, right? You know, the chairs here. So those were our plots, and we had replicated treatments. So we had two plots where we didn't do anything to them. We had two plots where we added a quarter inch of ice in 1 year, which was last year. We had two plots that we treated with half an inch of ice 1 year, that was last year. We had two plots that we treated with 3/4 of an inch of ice, and we had two plots that we treated with half an inch of ice in 1 year, and then just this last January, half an inch of ice in the second year. So the question there is, well, we think these forest plots can recover for perhaps 1 year of icing, one day ice storm, they're kind of adapted to that. But if these become more frequent and they get hit year after year, can they recover from multiple ice storms? So kind of, this is actually my favorite of our set of experiments. So just, this is the Hutterbrook Valley. I've kind of showed you that before. Our plots are right up in the middle of the Hutterbrook Valley. They're situated between the roads, so we can get to them in the Hutterbrook. So we actually have water here. This is the layout of a plot, 20 meters by 30 meters. And we do all our measurements in an inner 10 by 20 meters, so we don't have to worry about edge effects. So we ice the whole thing, but we do all our measurements here in the middle. And we basically measure everything we can possibly think of. So we have physical parameters like soil, air, temperature, soil moisture, lots of tree parameters, forest health, foliage, litter, microbial dynamics. Peter Rothman is our lead on the microbial part of this project, biogeochemistry, and we have wildlife work. So a very comprehensive, very controlled look at ice storms. So the way you do this is you start in 1 year, and you do your pretreatment year, and you measure just about everything you can measure on that list, so you know how the forest is behaving before your treatment. We also spend a lot of time on trying to figure out how to put water up in the air in a controlled manner with pumps and hoses, and this is actually a lot more complicated than you would think, but we had to do it. We had to do it precisely. It had to work in freezing conditions, and we had to do it safely. So we really spent a lot of time, I think I got a kick out of it, but you know, throwing water up in the air and having hose bites and all kinds of crazy things out in front of Hutterbrook. Now, my computer's a little wonky here, but let's see if I can get this to work. Let's see if this is the right one. So the next two videos is I want to invite you into our experiment. Right? I want to share with you what it's like to do one of these experiments and what it's like to be there on the ground, if it will work. Hang on. Things never work the way you want them to work. So we try this again. Bear with me. It's worth waiting for. So that was a little bit of what it looked like. like, and this is what it looked like the next day. I'm going to take this back to the beginning because I can.
Increase
from the low, the medium, to the high. So you begin to quantify the amount of the stuff that comes down with these cold ice storms. This is the big stuff, this woody debris. Not a very good picture, but the guys out there picking up this woody debris, weighing it, and again, just this tremendous amount of woody debris that came down, particularly in our three quarters of an inch. So one of the things we're seeing is real tipping points out in the forest, and I don't really have time to talk about that, but I think it's going to be really useful. This is from Wendy's and Hannity cover. The red is 2015, the pre, the blue is after. This is the control, no real change in percent Hannity cover. Didn't see a much of a change in our low treatment, a little bit of a decline in the medium treatment, and about half of the Hannity cover lost in that high treatment. So again, pretty numbers, you know, what we can see, you know, visually, when we're standing out in the plots. So we would think that opening up of the canopy would create these big gaps and would warm the soils. We have about 120 soil sensors out there. They track each other very nicely, and we're beginning to see kind of separation of our different plots. This is just one day to give you an example. This is just the temperature and the control, temperature in the tree, in the low, medium, and high. And there's about a 3/4 degree. See, different sounds, not like a lot, but that can be very significant to the microbes below there. So again, we're beginning to pick up these signals. Soil respiration is something that we measure. Soil respiration is the combined respiration of microbes and fine roots. Soil respiration, believe it or not, is the second largest flux in the global carbon cycle. So if you have any change in soil respiration, right, that can be really significant because it's such a large flux. We were sure that we were going to see an increase in temperature in the higher treatment plots, and soil respiration was going to be stimulated. And in fact, we saw just the opposite. Very subtle, but we actually saw the highest soil respiration in our low treatment plots and the lowest in our high treatment plots. So kind of an example of science is not always what you expect it to be. Same thing with soil solution nitrate. Remember when I said you got to remember this point? And so after the real ice storm, the 1998 ice storm, we saw about 3 or 4 months after, even into the growing season, we just saw this huge export of nitrogen. But we haven't seen any sign of it in our plots here. It was a very dry summer, so things may, you know, get kind of, you know, may just a dam down. We may see a lot of it next summer, or maybe something else is going on. So again, kind of one of those surprises, and not seeing results or significant differences can be as interesting as seeing significant differences. And I always have to remind our grad students about that. A little bit about birds and bugs. Wendy Lewenberger, the famous grad student in the future, is doing her master's student on this. And just kind of an interesting story here, if you'll bear with me, but she basically took leaves from the different plots, so from the high treatment, medium, and low, and she took them back to Syracuse, and she grew caterpillars on these leaves. And lo and behold, she found that the relative growth rate of the caterpillars was proportional to the treatment. So these caterpillars grew much better and faster on the high treatment leaves. And then she went back and she looked at birds on the plots. And there was no difference in the ground foragers. There was no difference in the bark foragers. But lo and behold, those birds that eat caterpillars were visiting those plots in much greater numbers. So again, we're looking at the direct and indirect effects. We're looking at physical properties, the biogeochemistry, but also this cascade of impacts through the trophic levels through the food chain. So kind of interesting preliminary results there. I just want to mention briefly that we go beyond the direct science in this project, and we're very devoted to communicating with a larger group like you guys. But we also held an ice storm roundtable with stakeholders. We did this December 19th. We invited people from the electric power industry, from public safety, arborists, foresters, people from the national parks, people from AMC, basically to come talk to us in a two-way dialogue. We didn't want to just tell them what we were doing, but we wanted to hear from them to know what they needed to know and whether we could tweak our experiment in some way that might be useful to them. So we had a good conversation. Ian Hom is amazing. He got his hands on these vintage snow cats. So we all went up into the watershed in these vintage snow cats and had some great conversations up there. So again, I'm trying to, not just, be in our own little box, but talk to a broader community. And the whole goal here is to help our communities be better prepared for these types of storms. So one last video, if this will work. And this is just kind of my ending video, and the National Science Foundation and the NSF 360 series put this together last winter, and they do a much better job of wrapping up than I do.
There's some very cool science going on in New Hampshire. An NSF-funded team of scientists has captured one of nature's most destructive forces, ice. Large ice storms are expected to become more frequent in the northeastern U.S. They disrupt lives and damage infrastructure in towns and cities in northern New England, resulting in billions of dollars of damage. Ice also reshapes the forest with toppled branches and reduced tree growth and changes habitat for wildlife. The team says science is critical to understanding the extent of these changes and their short and long-term effects on northern forests. The unpredictable nature of ice storms makes studying them a real challenge. So instead of waiting for the next big storm to hit, the team created their own suite of experimental ice storms in 8 large plots on the USGA's Hubbard Brook Experimental Forest and National Science Foundation long-term ecological research site. After a year of preparation, all the team needed was to wait for several consecutive days of cold temperatures in the single digits and enough snow to maneuver the utility vehicles. The team finally caught a break in late January. Using firefighting equipment, generators, and low-pressure pumps, the team directed nearby stream water through 1.5-inch hoses to a second set of high-pressure pumps mounted on utility vehicles. These pumps then push the cold water 100 feet into the air, falling back over the forest as a fine mist, freezing on contact. The team iced 8 plots, each the size of a basketball court. The scientists then went to work using wooden ornaments with arms to measure the ice accumulation, hoping for the right amount of ice on each plot needed to create the sweep of perfect storms. Having successfully created this ice lab, the team now begins observing and gathering data about the kinds of changes these extreme weather events cause to forests and wildlife. The team hopes this research provides the scientific community, land managers, and the public with greater insight as to the impacts of these powerful winter storms on the ecosystems in the northern hardwood forests. This project is led by Syracuse University, the Cary Institute of Ecosystem Studies, Cornell University, the University of Vermont, University of Southern Maine, and the Hubbard Brook Research Foundation.
Okay, so just kind of to sum up, we know that ice storms are a big deal. We know that if they do become more frequent and more severe, we really need to know about them. We know they're incredibly difficult to study. We have found a way to study them. We're very excited. We've done our first 2 years of icing, and we're beginning to accumulate information and search results, and we actually expect to be studying these plots for decades to come, which is the hallmark of the kind of science that we do at Hubbard Brook. And we really hope, in general, that the kind of information that we produce are going to allow people who are working in our communities to be kind of proactive instead of reactive. So that's all I got. I asked you questions. You can ask me questions.
saying you actually worked in climate change, as has been talked about in the press?
The question is, did I have to fill out a form that I work in climate change? I work for the USDA Forest Service, and I did not. And we did not have a gag order.
And I guess the more serious question is, what happens if there is a cutback in the government funding of this? Because you need to do follow-up, as you said, for decades.
So that's a very good question. The question is, what happens if there is a cutback in funding? We hope that we can continue our public-private partnerships so that all people like you can help us through our friends of Hubbard Grove, the Hubbard Grove Research Foundation, that helps support our work, or through other universities and partners that we work with. So anybody that knows me, I can be an optimist. We will find our way around this. But we hope that doesn't happen. We do, just kind of to expand that on that a little bit. If you remember, we were established as a center for hydrologic research, and that's studying water. And I don't care where you are in the world or in the country, people care about water, and that's part of what we study. So. Yes?
Have you come up with any recommendations for property owners for towns to try to mitigate damage from these ice storms?
So that's a really good question. Have we come up with any recommendations for how to mitigate? That is why we invited the stakeholders to come talk to us so that we could coordinate the kind of information that they might find useful. We were actually kind of stunned that they were so interested in, you know, our simple cause and effect about why you have a quarter inch of radial ice accretion and you get this much coarse and woody debris, you get a half inch, you get this, you get... So they basically set up in their neck of the woods. They had none of that information to begin to figure out salvage costs. You know, the folks from the electric power company, they basically said, you know, after the 1998 ice storm, they went from trimming lines every seven years to every 5 years. But based on Captain Hale's work, which is not completed yet, if we expect greater frequency of this, that might, you know, be back to what they're doing. So a lot of interest, but it's going to take that two-way dialogue to help us translate what we're learning, you know, and ask the right questions.
Yes. There seems to be much enthusiasm among the people from the utility companies to start getting wires on the ground.
You know, that's a good question. Is there any interest to put wires underground? Northern New Hampshire and Maine, probably not. The sheer extent. I know in some of the new developments where I live in Maine, all the utilities are going underground. You know, whether it's due to, you know, the ice storms, I'm sure that will figure into it in the future, but not across the board that I know. Yes?
Is it possible that ice storms actually are beneficial to forest ecology in some way, or provide a geo?
Well, you know, we might be able to address that question. Again, this idea of the light icing kind of thinning, right? Thinning out some of the dead wood, opening up the canopy, you know, letting some of the, you know, the understory come out. That's very possible. These catastrophic storms, like our 3/4 inch, is pretty devastating. And we're going to be very interested to see what comes back. We're actually interested in ecological tipping points as well. And one of the things, if you hit these things so hard or in multiple icings, do you get the same force coming back? You know, or do you get like a firm weight, you know, that comes back? And the structure and function, you know, might be dramatically different. You know, so it can go both ways, I think. Yes.
Is it possible that the major icing
yes, sir, or any canopy disturbance, you know, pests, pathogens, gypsy moths, you know, of moving that material. So, and that's what part of what we're interested in. So the question, just to do my job and repeat it, does this work like a forest fire of moving carbon and nutrients from the canopy down to the soil. So the answer is yes, you know, of course it does, but it's a very different material. It takes a lot longer to decompose that wood. And one of our questions is, what happens to that carbon and nutrients? Does it decompose slowly? Does it get kind of taken up, stored in the soil? Does it get recycled into the vegetation? Or does it get decomposed and gets lost out the bottom? Right? And that way, if we're losing nutrients out the bottom, that would be an issue for the forest.
Is there indication, since you got more caterpillars with the icing, that that's going to mean that some of the invasive species like Japanese beetle are going to become more of a problem?
The question is, we did see the caterpillars, we had a hint that they might do better, at least in the initial year, with other beetles or other insects also doing better. We actually did beetle studies, with foreign beetle studies out there. We don't have the results from that. But again, there is a question of what pests and pathogens are coming in. Paul Schauberg is a plant physiologist, and he also looks at insult to injury. He wounds the trees before the icing experiments, looks at wound closure, looks at pests, looks at pathogens coming in. So we are looking very closely at that.
Have you done any studies in primeval forests? And this is all new forests.
Yeah.
Where the trees have been there, never been cut down. The relationship to their existence in ice?
Well, the concept, so the question is, how would this play out in a primeval forest that hasn't been cut down? These are about 100 years old. They were cut at the turn of the century. So the concept of a primeval forest is kind of interesting. Forests are always undergoing change. These forests might live, 200, 300, but maybe an ice storm, a hurricane, a forest fire. These are things that reset our forests, even without human disturbance in them. So ice storms, is a natural disturbance. These forests are adapted to ice storms. Now, our question is, if we get more of these, are these forests resilient to more severe and frequent ice storms? But again, just the idea of the primeval old growth forest, there's constant change in forests. I'm going to go to the back because I always look in the front. So we'll go to the very back row.
Yeah, a question on another concern of the forests are these sort of early season snowstorms that we get where we still have leaves on the trees.
Yeah.
And we're seeing a lot of damage. Can you comment on whether or not, is there any research going on to address that? And if there is research going on, should we anticipate that also being a larger problem? And now we have an ice storm problem, but we also have a sort of a shoulder season snow problem that's also going to damage our forests.
So that's a good question. It was an observation that we're having, if I can translate, wackier weather. And we have these early season snowstorms, late season frost is another one where we're certainly concerned about all of that. The snowstorms are interesting because basically they're similar to ice storms. It's all about water and water weight. And one of the things that we're starting to do with this is look at the surface area, look at the density of the ice that we put in to look at the loads. So whether it's dense ice or whether it's snow, really beginning to work with people we work with as frequently, the wood products industry, to understand when we're going to have those tipping points and breaking points. So they're all really important. And we're getting better tools to anticipate some of these. But we do know that one of the signals we're getting with the changing climate is kind of a lackier weather.
One more question, also in the back.
Yes.
Have you or other colleagues considered undertaking, or are there long-term plans to undertake an evaluation of impacts of these ice storms on, for threatened and endangered species, such as those we have here in our own region, the bats, timber rattlers, and frogs that are barely hanging on by a thread. And would this be, to use your term, a tipping point that they might be facing?
So the question is there any research on the effect of these catastrophic storms on endangered species? I don't know of them. These types of extreme weather experiments are very extreme and very rare. You know, one of the things that we're accomplishing is actually showing other people how to do extreme weather experiments, and then being able to do them at a scale that's large enough, you know, that might affect these. I think what might be most important is the climate modeling component that Catherine Hayhoe, you know, we're kind of just, you know, waiting breathlessly to see what her very sophisticated climate modeling is going to suggest. And then we can take that and translate that into what that might mean on broader scales.
So I'd like to thank our speaker again and say us that much data in such good form, and in talk about wacky weather, it's always welcome to the audience. Thank you for coming out, and see you March 10th.